One second. Okay, we're set, we're handled. We are ready to go. We're live streaming to YouTube now and everything is good. So thank you for your patience. Thank you for being here and welcome. I will do my little spiel, Alx. I just want to let people know that my name is Judy Kitt. I'm the president of the Foundation for Mind Being Research, or FMBR. We've been around for 42 years, almost 43 now, exploring the intersection of science and consciousness and spirituality. So since 1980, we've been a forum for scientists and healers and artists and shamans and researchers who are trying to understand the nature of reality and expanding the context within which we see ourselves. And so you can check us out at fmbr.org or on YouTube at FMBRTV. So we're very honored to have Alx Uttermann here with us this evening. I first heard Alx speak about 6 months ago on another program, and I was blown away with her clarity and her wit and the joy that radiates from her. Alx is a healer, a minister, and a teacher who has spent the last couple of decades conducting healing workshops and trainings in a wide array of healing techniques and spiritual knowledge from ancient India. Over many years of intensive study at Sri Kaleshwar Soul University in southern India, Alx gained an in-depth understanding of the stresses facing human beings and the spiritual medicine, especially the miracles that dissolve them. Since returning to the US in 2005, Alex's work sharing these medicinal techniques has continued nonstop. Her goal is to spread the light far and wide to help bring relief, peace of mind, inspiration, and miraculous healing to whomever is in need. So Alx, welcome. And I can't think of a better time for you to be here with us. There's a lot going on, right? Especially right now. And I don't know if you saw the beautiful moon that's out. The full moon and eclipses and God knows what's up with humanity. So
this full moon, which is the Kartikeya Purnima, is the full moon of the, it's the, you know how they have Diwali in India? It's like the big celebration day of the light. This is considered the Diwali for the gods. So it's the celestial plane is... it's really incredible timing to have the American election.
right. So we're in for a ride, of course. We're in a ride. We're on a heck of a ride. So thank you for being here. And can't wait to hear what you have to tell us about.
Oh, it's a huge pleasure. I need to find out how long are we speaking? Because I suspect that, as usual, I've over-architected my slideshow. And if I need to surf through it and avoid certain things, I can, or, you know,
about an hour or so. And then depending on if people have questions and we can talk after that. So I'm going to actually turn it over to you and just put you on the speaker there.
Fabulous.
So everyone can see only you.
Oh, good God. Sorry. Hi, everybody. And also, can people unmute and speak as well, or is it chat only? Or
they can. So if you are on Zoom and you want to ask a question, you can raise your hand.
Got it. Okay.
And I will unmute, and you then people can ask you directly, or you can put a question in the chat.
Okay. I just want to know if we have a feedback mechanism like that, because my style is sort of like, if something's interesting to you or you didn't get it, just pipe up and say, what?
Yeah.
How does that work?
Yeah, you can do that. And if you're watching on YouTube, then I will be monitoring that as well. And I have someone else monitoring to send me questions. So it's okay to interrupt you if
yeah, sure. Yeah.
There are questions.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So Linda C has her hand up already, and I'm gonna ask you, Linda. Oh, did I lose her?
Yeah.
Well, I think I lowered her hand. Okay, if you have something you need to ask right now, Linda, go ahead and raise your hand again. Otherwise, I'm gonna turn it over to you, Alx.
Great. Well, hi everybody, and thank you so much for being here. It's a great pleasure, of course, and a huge honor to talk to so many spiritual scientists and scientific spiritual researchers. And I would definitely classify myself in that category. And what I thought to do was to present on the energetics of self-care, which is one of the beautiful systems that I learned in. I spent many years living in South India training with young happy guy there, Kaleshwar, who was a miracle healing saint. And among the many techniques that he gave to humanity to help us handle the challenges of the modern world, especially from a healing point of view and a slightly supernatural point of view. This is one of the systems. Actually, there's a couple of them that come into play in this discussion. And I have a slideshow, so I will share the screen and get the slides going. And then we'll talk through this energetics of self-care, which is my term, not his. And let me make it full screen so that we really have the nice, there we go. And okay, so welcome to my slideshow. I love these kind of online TED Talks, they're really fun. So this is all about extreme self-care. And this is a kind of quick overview of the concepts and the techniques involved. And I will share a practical technique so that everybody can actually try it. And I'm grateful to know we have an hour because I think I could kind of get through the basics here in an hour. This material really warrants a deeper dive. I should just say that. And normally when I present it in its full form, to really learn it and grab some of the nuances of it and the discussion around these kinds of techniques, to give it its due, it would take a few hours. But we have the super high shortcut, get to the chase version here. So who is this kind of training for? Anyone who is interested in self-healing, number one. And my God, like Judy was saying, we certainly all need that right about now, isn't it? This whole planet, I think, has been going through some remarkably stressful times over the last several years. And if ever there were a clarion cry for self-healing, this would definitely be it. Anyone in the helping professions, the occupations where they're really on the line, often listening to and receiving the stress from other people. Anyone in the healthcare professions, that could include dental, medical, all the support people around those kinds of professions, from hygienists to phlebotomists to, whatever. Especially frontline health workers. I made this presentation initially for our folks on the front line because the amount of stress, trauma, overwhelm, burnout, and PTSD that they're experiencing during the coronavirus pandemic has been off the charts. Who is this training for? Parents, especially the ones who were until recently stay at home with perhaps many children and juggling their jobs and trying to do online schooling and all the rest. Anyone in the service occupations, where you're providing beautiful service for other people and dealing with other people quite a lot throughout the day, all kinds of service occupations, ranging from in-person to customer service on the phone, etc. Veterans, anyone especially who was in any kind of military combat or military situation, maybe they grew up in a war zone. Healers of all kinds. That ranges from Western medical to energetic healers to psychotherapists, acupuncturists, body workers, the gamut, any kind of healer. Anyone who might be suffering or know someone who has PTSD or depression or anxiety or addiction issues. Extremely helpful for anyone who's been facing overwhelm and feelings of burnout as well. So just to give a quick little vision of what do I mean by healing. I think everyone's pretty aware there are body-mind connections, right? There are spiritual or subtle form connections to the whole process of whatever it is that happens in the human system. For the sake of ease, I broke it into four categories: body, mind, emotions, and the soul, the inner essence of what we are. And soul healing, which is sort of where the miracle energy lives and where I tend to navigate and operate the most. Again, I'm making this very simple, but there are two kind of components to healing at the level of the soul. Body healing is pretty easy. Emotional healing, pretty easy. with certain kinds of miraculous techniques, getting to the essence of a person's soul, their spark that they came in on, you could say that they are, the spark of the sort of source of the light, helping that find itself. And in the process of that, being able to shed the physical, emotional, other kinds of traumas that we might be experiencing or holding in the form. To me, that's the bedrock of the whole process of healing. To break that down, charging and decharging. What on earth do I mean by this? So glad you asked. So charging and decharging to the level of the soul. Charging would be positive charges. And I'll explain what I mean by this in a minute. It's kind of like the human organism is like a battery in the sense that we're mostly liquid. We can hold, we have semi-precious minerals and metals in us, right? And that we can hold positive and negative charges at our deepest subtle level. So positive charges would be charging. And I'll talk a little bit about what I mean by that. And decharging, which is one of the energetics of self-care techniques, getting rid of negative charges, dissolving them. So, hey, the human system, it's like a battery. Gosh, it's like an echo in here, holding positive charges. So positive charges would be, you know, beautiful experiences, a beautiful piece of music or a moment in nature or something that really moves the heart. When the heart is moved, the soul is stirring also. Gorgeous walk in nature, a beautiful scene in nature. You see a waterfall or a sunset that takes your breath away or even makes tears come to your eyes. That's your own soul is thrilled. It's letting you know, oh, we're receiving that, we're drinking that, which is why these things feel so good. Sorry about that. A beautiful exchange with someone, right? A heartful communication. These are all very positive charges to our inner, you know, battery, our soul battery, you could say. So we want to keep those. We want to hold positive charges in our system, like heart-moving experiences through the arts or through nature. Healing energy that we're receiving, maybe someone's praying for us or giving us some kind of a healing exchange. Nurturing relationships, a good meditation, some kind of inspirational moment that hits, you know, like if you hear a speech by Martin Luther King Jr. or you hear some great motivational speaker really touch your heart, like these kinds of things. Gratitude, immense positive charge to our system. Of course, being in love and kindness, both giving and receiving, and being of service to others is an enormous positive charge. For anyone who's ever done any kind of volunteerism or just lent a helping hand to a friend in need, you know the reflection that you receive from that is the gratitude that they have. That goes on your sort of soul battery, you know, your bank account, as it were. We want to keep those. Negative charges. Well, they probably don't need much introduction, but anyway, unfortunately, we hold these as well, unless they're dissolved through some energetic means. So trauma, getting yelled at, painful moments, you know, extreme stress, etc. Painful interactions, like someone yelled at you, or you got in an argument, or there was an abusive situation going on. You know, the kind of thing where if you have an argument with someone and it's pretty heated and a lot of regrettable things are said, in the aftermath of that, frequently we're shaking. Like you can feel a kind of physical shaking. What is that? That's literally your system received a negative charge. And it's that shaking is kind of like your soul saying, hey, go, that's too much. That's too much. That's an overload. That is an overload. We can't even process that. We would call it adrenaline or something like that. But my experience is it's our inner essence is actually shaking. Work-related stress and burnout, addictive behaviors, anything related to post-traumatic stress from any kind of trauma, emotional or loss or, you know, violence or whatever, either current or past. When anyone is in a presenting or performing or a teaching role where all eyes are on you, that's actually a kind of, we're receiving a lot of everybody else's stress automatically. So that can be a kind of negative charge in our system. Absorbing the stress, the pain, the fear from other people. And right now I'd say, you know, America generally is a place where there's a lot of that happening. Or if you're actually actively engaged in doing healing or helping work. And I'll talk a little bit more about these things, but let's just lump all of that under the category negative charges that we really don't want to hang on to in our soul battery. So there are subtle negative charges. I mean, it's obvious, right? If someone yells at you, that's pretty negative. Or if you cut someone off in the freeway and they give you a nasty look, that's, you feel it, right? That's a kind of negative charge. Those are fairly obvious things. But there are subtle negative charges where we absorb stress automatically and may or may not be aware of it. And the killer is, it's kind of like, you know, running a red light and getting busted for it and pleading ignorance of it. Ignorance of the law doesn't let you off the hook from the accountability for it. As human beings, we generally don't think that we're absorbing stress from these kinds of more subtle environmental forces, let's say. So I want to put this in the mix as well. The subtle negative charges, whether you think it or you don't think it, whether you believe it or you don't, we still absorb this kind of stuff. So automatically, we absorb stress from other people. You have a beautiful conversation with somebody and they had something painful happen. They tell you about it. If you're listening with an open heart, automatically you're absorbing some of that. It could be a stressful work environment. It could be a heated group meeting. It could be the environment that is around us, our workplace, our society, you know, a dysfunctional family, whatever it is that's around us, or a high stress environment, you know, an emergency room, for example. Automatically, we're absorbing stress there. We also automatically absorb stress from creating or participating in an energy shift or a healing for another human being, which could be a good friend has a, you know, a trauma and they tell you about it and you're listening for an hour with a big open heart. After that hour, they feel great and you feel, how do you feel? Might be enervated, might be exhausted, might be drained, might be frazzled. Might be, oh my God, I need a stiff drink, or I need a whole chocolate cake to eat, or we deal with it differently, but there's been an energy shift that occurred, meaning they offloaded something. You were the vehicle through which it got offloaded. So guess what? Some percentage of that stress and trauma came to you without our notice. And we do this all the time, automatically, naturally, we do this. I mean, that's part of the role of being a human being, especially one with a good heart, you know? So no matter what that energy shift or that healing is, I would call that actually a healing experience, even if we're not thinking, well, but I just talked to my friend and I listened, because that's what you do with a good friend or a mate or a coworker or a kid. No, it's actually a kind of healing because there was a shift of energy there. So to define what I'm talking about when I say healing, whenever a person facilitates a shift in another person or a group of people, from a negative state to a positive one, healing occurs. It's automatic. In that energy shift, one person's stress or pain gets relieved, right? They feel better, they're lighter. Well, energy doesn't dissipate, it simply changes form. Where did it go? To the person facilitating the shift. This is why you see so many healers get sick. This is why you see so many physicians carry chronic depression. This is why you see dentists having the number one suicide rate in the medical profession. This is why you see body workers get ill. This is why you see it's a real phenomenon that happens. And it seems to me that very few either Western medical or energetic healers or people who are tuned into this kind of stuff, very few people seem to have this understanding actually. And I think we're the worst for that, both as a society and of course in our own lives. So we want to decharge those negative charges that we automatically absorb from other people. Just there's the recap of some of those things. Largest on the list from my perspective and possibly many of you, I don't know, but healing or helping work and how much pain, suffering, stress, fear we're automatically absorbing from other people all the time. It's true, like, for example, in corporate, if someone's a project manager or an HR person, or if you are simply the kind of shoulder that people come to cry on, they feel you have some energy, they feel you have an open heart and some wisdom. Those kinds of exchanges, especially if there are many throughout the day, really lead to quite a buildup of negative charge in our system, which if left unaddressed, will start to take us down. It will. we'll start to see illness or mental health issues or some kind of disturbance in our system, depending on our constitution and our neurophysiology and how we process that subtle level of stress. So when I originally made this exact presentation, I was talking to a group of nurses. So forgive me if you're not in a healing or helping profession, but I think that this is central to the whole discussion. And also you may know somebody in this situation. So this would definitely be helpful information for them to receive as well. Why does anybody go into a healing or a helping profession? Right? Generally, they have a big open heart and they want to help other people. Whether they want to be a veterinarian and help animals, or you know, they go into nursing or something, psychotherapy, or you know, even project managing. I mean, you're helping the project, but you're also helping. It's a human dynamic there. It's not just on paper or on a digital information being exchanged. So anybody who has a big open heart, just naturally, regardless of profession, it's a big sponge. It's automatically absorbing from all these different factors, environment, other people, groups, situational stress, whatever it is. We absorb more stress and pain, more strain and suffering because we have a big open heart. So we're like a giant sponge, right? For all the stuff from everybody. And you'll hear, you know, people who are highly sensitive, they hardly can be around other people because they're so sensitive and they're so conscious of some of this. They feel assaulted. They feel overwhelmed. They're like, oh my God, I can't go into that place because it's so negative. And I'm going to feel like I'm kind of being bludgeoned energetically. That's a big open heart, one level. If we know how to manage that and wring out the sponge, it's not so bad. But we need to know that. And as a culture, generally in the West, we don't have any idea about that. So big heart is a big sponge. You've got to wring the sponge out effectively, not in an abstract or an esoteric way, but in a practical way that actually does something. I put this quote in here and I left it in even reviewing the slideshow today because it's interesting how that exact point was addressed by a politician. I mean this from the bottom of my heart. If there are any angels in heaven, they are all nurses. We know from our family's experience what you do, your courage, the pain you absorb for others. Thank you. Drum roll, Joe Biden, during the height of the pandemic. The pain you absorb for others. That's very clear. We have an intuitive feeling about that, but we don't know what to do with it, generally. So, just to recap, a big open heart is a big sponge. It absorbs more stress and strain, more pain and suffering from others. So what do we do about this? It's not a problem so long as we know how to manage the energy and decharge, dissolve the negative charge effectively. You could actually call this subtle energy management techniques, which I honestly feel like every human being should have access to this because it would calm everybody down so much that we can have clearer, cleaner interactions with one another, not fraught with so much of the dynamic from everything we absorb throughout the day in layers and layers and layers that kind of obscure who we really are when we're meeting another person halfway. It's like the layers that we've absorbed are between us and the other person, and they've absorbed a bunch of layers from others. And so there's a lot of stress and a lot of friction that isn't really that necessary if people know how to handle their energy. But as I say, generally we don't. And so the chaos and misunderstandings are the result. So what happens if we don't decharge, if we don't pull out those negative charges on a daily basis? The negative charges remain in our system, oh joy, and build up over time, leading to problems with health, emotions, sleep, coping substances, building up to ultimately burnout, or the physical system starts to get really ill before the psychological symptoms of burnout occur. It just depends on someone's neurophysiology. We're all a little bit different how we process these kinds of stresses. Yeah, big ouch. So there's good news. Now we've made the case, what is the situation? our physical and our energetic systems always move toward balance and healing. Always. Naturally, our system, our, you could call it our essence or our soul or our core or however you describe the innate intelligence that's in us, always wants to go in that direction. Our systems literally give us warning signs that we have hit critical mass for perhaps today or perhaps the week or perhaps the month, that we have absorbed so much from everybody around us in that sort of inner soul battery or that sponge, that the system's in overload. And if we don't decharge it, we're going to get seriously afflicted. So some symptoms literally indicate that decharging is needed. This is not a comprehensive list. I have a much larger training that goes more specifically into this, but here's some of the top 10. Physical aches and pains, especially headaches. It's interesting how much we normalize that in our world, right? You come home from a hard day of work, you might have a headache, you might have back pain, you might have something. And generally we'll take some pill, you know, Tylenol or aspirin or something, or go to a body worker and pass all that stress on to them. So they decharge us by working on us and now they're stuck with it, right? We normalize it like that's okay. I'm fine because this is just my normal aches and pains in my normal day. I would argue, no, it is not. Your own physical system is having a big revolt and it's putting up red flags and it's saying, you need to handle this. You've absorbed too much energy for you today and we need to decharge it. Itching, burning eyes. Frequently, I will see after a big healing exchange or someone's had a very stressful day of doing healing work or medical or something, they have itching, burning eyes. They think they have an allergy. They don't. Their system is saying you need to decharge. Lack of appetite or nausea. Anger or irritability. You know, especially after a number of exchanges where maybe everybody coming to you was pretty angry. Let's say you work in retail and everybody's kind of edgy and grouchy or customer service. Good God. How do you think the folks on the other end of the customer service calls feel by the end of a shift? Yikes. If it's out of control, anger, irritability, yeah, you need a decharge. You got a lot of negative inputs that day and they're just sitting there in the soul battery stewing in there. Sleep disturbances like insomnia or nightmares or a restless sleep, you know, like you go to sleep okay, but you kind of can't sleep through the night. Restless, disturbed. I think there's some incredible stat about, is it like 2/3 of Americans or I think take some sort of sleeping aid at night? We have a national, I would call it a decharging emergency, but we have a problem with the amount of stress levels that we're processing and unbeknownst to us are really torturing us from the inside. And our systems are trying to tell us, hey, you need some vehicle through which to decharge all of this stuff. Fatigue and exhaustion. Obsessive, anxious thoughts and worries. Can't get out of that cycle, right? That's also kind of a PTSD, that free-floating anxiety that will not stop. Especially you'll see it with people in the overt healing professions, psychotherapy or medical or legal. I had a beautiful friend who was defending kids who were accused of crimes. So he was representing them in court. He cared so much about these young kids who were like on the streets with prostitution and drugs and all that. You know, they're 11, 12, 13 years old. They were juveniles. He tried so hard to help them on all areas of their lives. And he finally had to stop representing children because he was driving himself mad. He was just obsessively thinking about them all night and worried for these kids. And his friends were like, you know what? Your own mental health is going down here. I will also say I have a colleague who is an internist, a brilliant physician, very open-hearted man who had a clinic in Mendocino County. And he described coming home from work at the end of every day, feeling like he had been hit by 10 trucks, absolutely flattened, unable to function, exhausted to the bone, foggy, like unconscious and not present with his wife, with his children. He actually lost his marriage. And he said, you know, I would sit in front of the television for a few hours after every day of work, seeing nothing, just channel flipping, whatever, smoking a lot of pot and trying to find some sort of, you know, decompression from his day. His statement was, I thought this was a doctor's life. This was what medical school was like. This is sort of like what everybody goes through. I just thought that was normal. He actually met my spiritual master, Kalishwar, and learned decharging. And he was like, you're kidding me. After a half an hour coming home from work, even on the way home from work, to use some of these techniques, it's gone. It's present, clear, sharp. It wasn't his stuff. He was a huge open-hearted man who was treating patient after patient after patient and absorbing automatically without his notice all of their stuff. And that, of course, was taking him down. By the end of the day, he could barely function. That's not unusual. Taking your work home with you, yes, problematic. So these are a few of the symptoms. There are many more. But you know, our own system is screaming at us, you need to decharge this stress. You need to come out from under this. This is not helpful. This is not healthy. And mostly we normalize all this, or we try to buy it off with different things. And so we're not skilled at hearing these symptoms or understanding what they're pointing to, nor do we have any real means through which to address it. So that's just, it's a gnarly situation to find yourself in as an individual or as a society. So there are many more. And as I mentioned, I do have a rather full, thorough, probably over the top training about all this that nails it all down quite concretely. Good news number two. So first good news is your system will tell you you have problems. Second is there's extreme relief available. Amazing. Instant, which sounds hyperbolic, it is not. Relief through these ridiculous, simple, effective techniques to decharge the stress and strain rapidly, which is what I've spent more than two decades now teaching and sharing this information with people who quite often are just stunned at the difference. I mean, it is really night and day to use these. So you can head off overwhelm, PTSD, and or burnout before it happens. Yes, you can deal with it after it's there, but oh my God, why not prevent it and do it on a daily basis? You know, it's kind of like when you brush your teeth. Of course, we do that every day, right? You don't want a 6-month buildup and then the hygienist yells at you because you have so much plaque in there is causing you damage, right? Gum issues, tooth issues, and whatever. Similarly, if we decharge daily, if we handle our stuff daily, if we become attuned enough to recognize, hey, I'm having these symptoms. Oh my gosh, I think the alarm bells are going off. I really need to decharge. If we do it every day, like a practice, like brushing your teeth every day, then there's no buildup, right? The plaque doesn't build up, you know, there's no consequences down the road and so on. So it's like a maintenance, actually. As a registered nurse of an inpatient psychiatric unit, decharging has not only become a necessary part of my daily life, but I've also shared it with coworkers. I'm so grateful for this very simple technique so I can rid myself of the stress from my day. I highly recommend this as one of your daily self-care techniques. Happy decharging, says Susie Scarpacci, an RN. Before these tools, feeling emotionally overwhelmed had become a daily occurrence in my life. After learning about energies and how the people we come into contact with affect us emotionally, everything fell into place. I now use these tools every day. It's made me a better caregiver and a more compassionate human being. Janet Garibay, she's an office manager for a very, very, very busy, very successful chiropractic business here in LA. And everybody comes in with their pain. Everybody comes in with their suffering. And she and her colleagues, these angel women, are the first greeting people. They're the first on the receiving line to hear what's going on. They do the intakes. They hear the pain and the suffering before the people ever get to the chiropractor. So when I first met them, they were three young angelic women who were all just like gray, energetically and emotionally, and they were super burned out and they're dear, dear souls. So I taught them how to decharge, and yeah, you see the difference. So again, just to recap, we want to decharge the negative charges, which might include some of these things, right? Painful experiences, any kind of time that you're in a presenting or a teaching role and all eyes are on you, which is, I would classify that as more of a subtle negative charge, addictive behaviors, work-related stress and burnout, PTSD kinds of stuff, trauma from the past or present. And especially this idea of absorbing the stress, the pain, the fears from others around us, either through direct interaction or environmental or however that goes, especially healers. And yes, of course, we all absorb a lot from the news. We absorb it via social media. If you've ever had people troll you on social media and hurl all kinds of nasty stuff at you, you also, I'm sure, know that feeling very well. So let's talk about, I want to give one technique as a practical thing that maybe everybody can do. I don't know, but I had written Judy and said, can everybody have a candle? So if you have access to a candle, just real flame, not an artificial one, but actual flame with a lighter, it would be a great idea to kind of get that ready because we're going to use the fire element. It's a very rapid way to offload the stress that we're carrying. So decharging stress, when we're decharging it through these kinds of techniques, we are literally giving the stress back to nature. Where it originated, the big cosmic nature that created everything on this planet, including all of us, and all of the crazy interactions we have with each other, is kind of like nature created the problem. So the solution is give it back to nature through the doorways of four of the five great elements that comprise this nature and indeed comprise our own human energy system. You know, in the knowledge of Vedic India, they will say everything in this world is made of the five elements, the earth, the fire, the sky, the water, the air. Namah Shivaya. And those elements, you know, like in our human system, we have the dense, gross bones, right? That is like the earth element structure in our form. We have fire. We have digestive fire. Yes, that's true. But we also have the fire of inspiration, of creativity, of brilliance. You know, even the word inspiration has pyros in it, fire from the Greek, inspiration. I'm inspired. You can see a spark in someone's eye or a twinkle, right? We have a lot of fire energy in our body in different ways. Water energy, obviously. I mean, we're, what is it, 75% liquid? We've got the circulatory system and the reproductive systems, and we have the saliva, and we have so much water in forming our flesh. We're mostly water in a kind of replica of our planet Earth, which is also majority water, right? And the air element, which is the in-breath and the out-breath, without which none of us could survive longer than a few minutes. We don't talk about the Akash or the sky element simply because it's so infinite. The thought is it infuses all of these other more gross material, tangible elements. So for purposes of decharging majority, we're using the more tangible elements. There are techniques involving the earth element, which is a huge magnet to offload our stress to. There are techniques to use the water element, but I thought for purposes of an easy demonstration, we could use the fire element tonight. So there's a simple four-step process to decharging. It goes like this. Oh, but first let's talk about the fire. And now I'll explain about the four steps. So you can use fire in a candle or candles, right? You can have a whole bank of candles. You can just have one flame. It really doesn't matter. If you have oil lamps, great. You can use that, just natural flame. If you have like a fireplace or a wood stove, you know, fantastic. Any live source of the fire can be used for this kind of decharging experience. An outdoor fire, obviously. Why do we all love the fire? You know, I don't think there's a single person who doesn't enjoy staring at a fire or a candle. Why do restaurants put them on the tables? Why do churches use them or temples? There's flame in so many of our deep connected human experiences represented there. The fire's nature is it purifies the atmosphere. It burns negativity just by being there. And also it softens the atmosphere through the process of burning negativity. So as we have a flame inside, we have this external flame, and we're going to have a kind of dialogue between the two. It is also true that the fire itself, any flame, it stands in as a microcosm of the sun's energy, of the sun's creation capacity, of the sun's enormous light, which really won't allow any darkness or shadows to stand. So this is the essence, this is kind of the feeling of the fire element. Also quite interesting, in the human system, the fire element itself links to our two eyes. You know very well if someone has a twinkle, right? I said that, a bit of a spark, or they have some intelligence or something. We usually see it in the eyes when someone is is pretty awake in there. Conversely, we see it when someone is pretty dull and covered over, and they're kind of, they've lost the luster in their face. They've lost the luster in their eyes. There's a sadness there. You can see grief in people's eyes and so on. So our eyes are kind of the vehicle through which we connect to the fire. I should also say that the two eyes are linked very strongly to the third eye, which is itself a kind of flame. So we're really dealing with this beautiful structure of the two physical eyes and the third, the eye of consciousness, when we're interacting with the fire element. It's also quite interesting if somebody shoots you a very pointed glance, like they want to get your attention, you'll feel it. Right? You can feel if somebody stares at the back of your head. They've done research on that. I think Rupert Sheldrake was, was very interested in that phenomenon. But it's also true, like if you upset somebody on the freeway and they shoot you a mean look, you feel it. You know exactly what happened there. It's in the eyes. We convey a lot. A loving glance also. You feel it. You don't even need the words. There's this exchange that happens right through the eyes. So linked all to the fire element. So the way we use the flame to decharge is you stare at it. Well, that makes sense. And I'll explain a little bit more about this technique in a moment. And then this four-part process, which I will also explain. Literally, this whole process of staring at flame with a kind of intention, which I'll explain in a moment, burns out whatever stress, whatever strain, whatever it was, these layers and overlays of other people's stuff that we picked up throughout the day unwittingly. Maybe we know it. Maybe there was an argument or a conflict or a tense situation or something like that. Okay. But even if there wasn't and we're feeling kind of meh, there's likely some layers of stuff that we've just automatically absorbed and we need to decharge that. So there are different ways you can use the fire element for the purposes of decharging. One is you can go straight to the sunrise. As the sun is rising, you can stare at it and think this beautiful process of the four steps, which I'll explain. You can use an outdoor fire. If you're so fortunate, maybe you have a fire table out in the backyard or something. Fantastic. A fireplace or a wood stove. Yes, even Pooh Bear needs to decharge. Oil lamps, very traditional in the Vedic. Indian tradition. Candles, of course. And I have to say, from my own side, for decades, every full and new moon, I conduct fire homas, which are extremely powerful. They're also called yagyams or agnihotra or havans. There's a whole bunch of names for this phenomenon, but it's using the fire in a very specific and powerful way, chanting prayers and mantras into the fire. And receiving through the eyes and the third eye, very, very profound charging, very high divine charging, and also immense decharging. I've done these every full and new moon, mostly without exception in the US since like the summer of 2005, I believe. Staring at a flame like that, at a sacred fire that's only for that purpose, is it kind of amplifies the whole experience of charging and decharging. So how we decharge through the fire element, we go through the eyes to any flame. You can also spread your fingertips. This is the extra credit thing. Let's say you have a little candle. You can spread your fingertips and kind of point them at the flame to offload this stress or strain that you might be carrying. The fingertips are also big conduits for energy, actually. Mostly we think about the palms, right? Because there's a chakra there, but the fingertips are very vibey. And you might also feel palpably that it passes. The energy is moving through the fingertips as well. Also by watching the sunrise, which is a really, really powerful, refreshing, renewing way to handle the fire element directly and to decharge a lot of stress and strain. I think I don't have the four. Oh, I do have the four-step process. Okay, so to decharge through the fire, you'll need some form of fire. And so hopefully everybody has a candle or something. Or like I was doing there for a class, you could have a whole, you know, bank of candles. And I really hope everybody has a candle. It'd be great to experience this together. So the four-step process goes like this. Number one, scan yourself for any symptoms. Maybe you had a really crappy day. Maybe you're just like, oh boy, do I need this decharging thing right now? I'm feeling stressed. look at where do you have body aches, headaches, burning eyes, crazy thoughts, compulsive behavior pulls. Maybe you have sleep disturbances. Maybe there was a situation that happened that you can't get out of your mind, etc. Look at your own physiology. Take a moment and just go inside and look at, how am I doing right now? Is anything aching, burning, upset, whatever? Just kind of retain that. Even if you want to write it down, you can, but just to retain, okay, well, this is my operating condition right now. The pre-decharging experience. So you take a moment, you scan yourself. Okay, is anything off? Good. Second, we're going to use the fire element form, which would probably be a candle, through the eyes. And this is so simple. This is how it works. And it is kind of unbelievable. And it is definitely kind of miraculous, even such a simple thing. You offer a prayer or a statement of gratitude. So maybe you have a sense that the intelligent, creative force in the universe is the universe, or maybe it's God, or maybe it's Jesus, or maybe it's Buddha, or maybe it's Mother Nature, or maybe it's your higher power, or maybe you're an atheist and you have a sense that you have a higher self somewhere in there. Whatever it is, it really doesn't matter. However you consider all of that, but to offer a prayer or a statement of thank you. When we are grateful, the heart opens. When the heart is open, energy automatically flows in and out. It's the key to how we receive or dissolve energy, be it positive or negative. So we're literally, what would you say, inviting our heart to open by offering up a moment of real gratitude. Thank you so much. What are we thankful for? This element that I'm using right now. So it might sound like, dear nature, dear God, dear Buddha, whatever. Thank you so much for this fire element that I'm using right now. Thank you. It's an acknowledgement of the majesty of nature, that these elements are existing in their raw forms for us to interact with the large cosmic nature through. Thank you. Thank you so much. Right? It's beautiful. The heart opens. It softens inside. Next thing is, right now, I'm decharging. Right now, I am dissolving whatever stress, strain, difficult things happened today, whatever I picked up that isn't me. And you simply stare at the flame with that intention running. So you scan yourself for the symptoms. You have your beautiful element there that you're going to use, in this case, the fire. You're offering this heartful recognition, hey, thank you, to whomever or whatever you like. Thank you for this fire element. And right now, that's important, right? It's not 10 minutes from now. It's not tomorrow. It's right this second. From my own inner consciousness, I'm saying, I'm going to decharge. I'm going to offload this stress right now. And here's the crazy thing. Your own system knows how to do this. When you make that intention, riding on the wave of the gratitude and your heart is open, automatically your system will start to throw it out through your physical eyes. It will pour it to the flame. And if you add the extra credit with the fingertips, you can feel that as well. Some people feel a flow of energy. Some people feel a kind of like falling into the flame. Some people are like, I'm just staring at a candle. I don't really feel anything. Some people may feel the symptoms start to diminish. And you don't have to keep at it in this kind of, I'm decharging. Right now I'm decharging. You set the intention. It's very innocent. It's very simple. It's very kind of organic. And you're just staring at the flame. It may be even you're listening to music, or there's a YouTube video playing, or whatever. It doesn't matter. Once you set that intention from your consciousness, your system automatically picks up the ball, and through your two eyes will start to offload to the flame. So I'm thinking, if people have candles, so then you simply let it flow. Just decharge those negative charges straight through your eyes to the candle or whatever form of fire you might be happening to use there. You can also extend your hands for those little fingertips, which are actually quite powerful. And so my feeling is, why not do that right now? If we could just, you know, even take, I don't know, like 2 minutes, just identify, where am I at right now? What symptoms might I have that are disturbing, either mild or acute? And if you have a flame, that would be great. Light it, thank the whatever for that beautiful flame, and simply stare at it. And let whatever it is come up and out. And I would think if you don't have a candle, you can definitely try this when you get offline and see what comes. Good. So I'm going to keep talking. You can keep decharging to your flame. And it will be very interesting to hear if anybody has any ahas or something occurs or whatever, but you can keep staring at the flame at least for another minute or two, just to get a little bit of the feeling of it. I would say generally, you know, it would take 5 or 10 minutes of having that beautiful interaction with the candle, but one never knows. It might be an acute need and something just pops up and out in the moment. So this is a beautiful statement from Chris DeMaio, who is a retired now psychiatrist, who was a Vietnam era veteran. He was in the Marines in Vietnam, and he was in a unit called the, I believe it was called the Unit of the Walking Dead. Ho Chi Minh made an example. He wanted to make an example of an American elite unit, and so bombed this particular group of men mercilessly. I think they originally had some hundreds of people in the unit, and over, I think, maybe 6 months or less, there were just maybe a couple hundred people walked out alive. It's a horrific chapter in the story of the Vietnam War. Anyway, Chris was there as a medic. He thought he was going to go to medical school and become a family physician. But instead, when he came out of that experience in Vietnam, his medical training went to psychiatry instead. He had extreme PTSD, as did many of his brothers and folks who had served in a combat situation there. And he dedicated his life actually as a psychiatrist, helping one part of veterans suffering with extreme PTSD. When we met him, Chris had, he was in his early 70s at the time. He was still having the flashbacks and the nightmares, having extraordinary compulsive, fearful behaviors, including taking evasive maneuvers home. He never went the same route twice from his office to his home, which was in a beautiful part of Santa Cruz. Like, this is not a crime-ridden, stressful, you know, paranoia-inducing kind of place. So he really had how I would characterize PTSD is it's an extreme negative charge that shattered the heart of a human being. You know, the heart, the soul in us is a tiny, delicate flame. It's very delicate. And to be exposed to horrors like that and to commit or witness atrocities as a young person, especially, which all those guys were, it's an extreme negative charge energetically in our system. And my experience is it takes an extreme supernatural divine force to pull that out, to decharge such like a solid injection into the soul of negativity. So we trained Chris in these different techniques. He took a lot of the different things that we had. He began doing the integrative meditation, which could be done anywhere at any time, and also decharging. And this is his statement about it. As a retired board certified psychiatrist, I'm convinced that exploration of various approaches and techniques to medicine can be extremely rewarding. Using the decharging techniques has been extremely helpful. There is a greater calmness. It is important to remember the meditation and decharge technique can be used anywhere, anytime. It does not require medication, another person, or a special setting. The meditation and decharge techniques are effective and a positive addition to my life. The incidences of the nightmares came down, the incidence of flashbacks came down, and he began to notice if he felt a flashback happening, he would immediately decharge through one of the elements and it would evaporate very quickly. So quality of life dramatically changed. And he said, as a clinician, this is my clinical observation using myself as a laboratory. So these techniques really work even for incredibly entrenched PTSD of horrific proportion. I think we're going to skip meditating because I think we want to get to the, sorry about this. I think, this I also want to tell people, this is my final little parting tip for stability. There's a thing called Vastu. Vastu is the ancient knowledge from which feng shui derived. It's unlike feng shui, it is not flexible. It is grounded in the elements and how they express in our homes, in our bodies, in our relationship to our environment, and so on. And there's this beautiful tip for increasing willpower and inner stability, which, you know, if you're lacking those two things, it's very easy to be even more assaulted and more absorbent in the world by the various stressors that we are exposed to simply by virtue of our resilience is a lot lower. And this is it. Don't sleep at the top of your head, top of your head pointing to the north, not any degree of north, not northeast, not northwest, nowhere in the spectrum of north. If you are confused, check it via Google, which is set to true north. Compass north can be a little bit misleading because it pulls off depending where you are on the planet. Absolutely no north in the direction your head is sleeping. Why? It's very destabilizing to the whole system. Emotionally, physically, it drains willpower. It's very hard to maintain any kind of healing or self-healing at all. It is actually quite recommended to put your head to the south. So you heard it here first. I'm sure everybody will be checking their direction, which way their head is when they're sleeping. So I'm looking forward to hearing your experiences with these self-care techniques and decharging through the fire element. We didn't talk about the meditation. I think that's a little bit more time consuming than we have right now, but that's something we can do in the future for sure. And sleeping with the top of your head to the south, highly recommended. Even if it makes your bedroom look bizarre, it's not about aesthetic, it's about energy. You can find me for more resources at energeticsofselfcare.com, which are the systems of decharging and integrative meditation, which comprise these radical self-care tools to bring relief to each of us, and rather immediately, actually. There's a full decharging training and the integrative meditation. You can also find me at ucbk.org is my more woo-woo spiritual life and work, including the fire homeless that I talked about, which we do live stream on a variety of platforms. And everybody's welcome to join. Surprisingly, you can get the energy of those fires and the decharging even through video transmission. It's quite something. And if you want to email me for any reason, hey, there's my email address. Love to hear from you. And I think that's it. Yes. Thank you so much for listening. And thanks for coming to our virtual TED Talk. And I'll certainly look forward to having a conversation about anything that interests anybody from this point.
Thank you so much, Alx. How wonderful. I'm just, you know, I feel, it's funny. I feel energized just from your talk. Yeah. And I want to let the people on Zoom know, I think I did something to the chat. It may work now. If you want to try it, or if you have questions, type them in the Q&A, or you can raise your hand.
Oh, and fabulous. It is working.
It is working. Okay. I found the secret.
Yay.
Okay. I have two questions for you to start.
Please.
Mm-hmm. And then jump in, everyone, if Mom, you want. My first question is, I'm guessing that some high percentage of people that you work with, people that come to you, are empaths, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And do you, I don't know for sure what my question is. You talked about that kind of big open heart,
mm-hmm.
right? And I imagine that a lot of people listening, a lot of people who are interested in the spiritual development and all of that are empaths. And I am so happy to have these tools, because I do think that taking on that energy of what you're experiencing, or what people are experiencing around you, is really debilitating. Mm-hmm. I don't know if I have a question in there. It's just, do you find that people who would not describe themselves as empaths are affected to the same degree?
Yes, not to the same degree. They don't notice it, but it's happening. They don't notice.
Okay, because it's
with or without your conscious awareness. My dad was a surgeon, small town surgeon, chief of staff of the hospital, and always on call for ER as well. And for 40 years, and the man was chronically depressed, unbelievably depressed, could barely function when he got home. And he was a huge open heart to his patients, huge open heart, phenomenal surgeon, a real medical practitioner in the old school way. He was absolutely miserable. And the reverberations of that on our whole family were dramatic and very toxic. He had a hair trigger temper and a lot of PTSD also from having served in the medical corps behind Patton's army in World War II. So he was also a veteran. And it was horrific. And, I find myself often thinking, God, if he'd only known, if he'd only had these techniques, so much of that, it was everybody else's stuff. It wasn't his. But he was carrying that. He was like vomiting it on our family at home and barely able himself to maneuver. It was really such a burden and completely unnecessary, but.
Yeah. But what you said, it's considered normal, right? Mm-hmm. Come home from work. Like my father, come home from work, have a drink or three. Right.
That's what they do.
Yeah, exactly.
And it normalizes, and it's trying to medicate all of this uncomfortableness. The system is screaming. We need relief. But because we're not educated in the West about how to address that need for relief, we're really left out to dry. Yeah. Oh. Yeah.
Christina says that when she's decharging, she yawns or sometimes has tears.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Is that common?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yawning is usually a huge negativity is coming out.
Mm-hmm. Anything else?
It's on a subtle level. Tears. Well, so let's say you had a traumatized day and some really painful things happened, and as you're decharging, those things are coming up and out of the system. It's not uncommon to kind of relive it for a second. You're like, oh, that thing that happened. You're kind of seeing it even while you're in the moment of decharging, meaning it's getting jarred loose from your subtle nervous system and is actually coming up and out through the vehicle of whatever element you're using to decharge. So that's not uncommon. I've also seen it where people have decharged for the first time in their life and they are just unglued sobbing because there's such a buildup. It's like, the Hoover Dam worth of a lifetime of crap in there that's not theirs. And to have any kind of valve open and be able to pour all of that out, even in some small 15-minute increment, it's overwhelming. We used to teach this for free in Santa Cruz at a spiritual bookstore many moons ago, and especially nurses and hairdressers were the two people who would come up in absolute tears, often saying, I thought I was crazy. I thought I was crazy. Oh my God, thank you so much. Because hairdressers are like everybody's amateur therapist, right? Everybody dishes to the to the hairdresser, and they have their hands in your extremely intimate, we carry actually a lot of stress and negativity in the hair. which is why I feel so good when it gets chopped. You're like, oh, what a relief. Yeah. So they're doing that. Their hands are in your kind of decharging vehicle there, the hair. And then they're listening to your stuff on top of it. And they're reeling with it by the end of the day.
That is amazing.
It's so intense.
Let me ask you, I'm only asking this because I was talking to some people earlier who had been at had gone out to see the full eclipse of the sun that happened 4 or 5 years ago. These are two men, you know, scientists, very Western trained, whatever. Both of them independently said that it was the most awe-inspiring experience they'd ever had. That when the eclipse reached totality, they wept.
Oh my God.
The whole crowd screamed.
Oh my God.
And it was they said it was like a religious experience. And I was thinking about those kind of overwhelming positive experiences, you know, like Stendhal syndrome, that kind of overwhelming beauty. Are these experiences that need to be decharged, or is this a good thing?
No, it's a massive healing that's happening there. It's a huge healing. You know, like if you hear a piece of music and it makes you go unglued, like sobbing, right? It's so beautiful. It's like it unlocks the heart and everything starts pouring out. It's a massive decharging, actually. And that kind of experience in nature as well is a huge decharging. The soul itself is like, oh, thank God, let's get rid of everything here.
Yeah.
It's so profound, you know. Somebody just wrote in the chat about flight attendants have what they call jump seat therapy, unloading with each other, right? Knowing you won't see that coworker again for months. It's very therapeutic. Yeah, except now everybody jumped in the muddy bath together and the water's there, but it's all muddy because it's like passing the, right? The conversations are helping to relieve some of it, yet the energetic charge will still be there. Flight attendants are really under it. You know, anybody who works in like restaurant service or that kind of thing, one level, they're really getting it in the teeth. But flight attendants, especially now with people going crazy about masking and getting aggressive and drunk and assaulting and all of it, oh my God, y'all are on the line and desperately need to decharge. I wish that the, you know, like the union of flight attendants would get a hold of these techniques and let us like license it to them or something and have it active as a union-wide activity that people can do, because honestly, I did all the self-care stuff over the years and meditations and this and that. I've never seen anything work the way that these kinds of techniques do. It's so instant and immediate. I was working with a marketing lady a while back. She has really strong corporate background and a lot of, you know, high credentials and all that. And I was telling her about this before she tried it. And I said, you know, I feel a little sheepish saying the results are immediate and you can instantly feel it, because it does sound like hyperbole. And there's so much hype out there and there's so much sales, there's so much nonsense in the spiritual arena, especially. And I feel a little like, I say it, but should I really say it? Because it sounds grandiose. She tried it. She came back to me. She was like, no, you need to say it. And you need to say it a lot. Oh my God, I've never seen anything work like this. I'm like, there you go.
You know, it's so interesting. I think, you know, when you were explaining it, I thought, you know, it's so therapeutic just to know that there's somewhere for this all to go with your intention, right? And I mean, people talk about grounding and stuff like that, but you know, I love that. And I have a friend who told me years ago, she said, I am afraid to start crying.
Exactly.
Because my fear is that if I started crying, I would never stop. That I would just never be able to stop. And it's that feeling, right? Yes. And what a very simple, powerful technique.
I do also want to offer that women, energetically, mechanistically, we handle 75% of the pain of the planet. Runs through the female systems, which is why also I hate to say, but the women are kind of big emotional ups and downs. And sorry, men, I know it's really difficult. And for, you know, people who are non-binary or trans, reflecting on where are the hormones and what is happening in your system, depending on what you were, you know, given at birth and so on. The female nature is we handle the pain. If you have a womb, you're handling the pain of the planet. And you don't even have to physicalize the womb. It could have been removed through hysterectomy. We still have that energy center, which means that women especially need to decharge. We really need to decharge. And my experience also is that the menstrual cycle is a natural decharging. It's built into the human system for the women. Like, well, you get to handle all this pain. You are the divine feminine in a form. You have the creative ability to create life. So we'll also give you this blessing, which is that for all the pain you absorb from your friends and family and coworkers and society and everybody you care about and all this that goes in there over a whole month's time, you can release it all very quickly in one giant deluge once a month. Mm. Two observations. Number one, our age now is so dense that that's not enough. Women who only rely on the menses are, you know, PMS, you could feel it. It builds up, builds up, builds up. What is that? Energetically, it's too much for the system. It's already done through like 20 days or whatever of the cycle. We've already absorbed our max. We are maxed out and we're hypersensitive and we're bloated and we're cranky. And all of that is screaming, I need to decharge. And I'm sure women are quite aware. Once the period starts, it's like, oh my God, we're relieved. And we're kind of wild, right? We're offloading a lot of fluid, a lot of water element going out. Fire element goes straight up. There's kind of an imbalance going on there. My advice is that if you decharge every day as a practice, you make it a 15-minute a day thing by the end of the day, whatever, before you go to sleep. What I observed was PMS symptoms came down, like they didn't exist anymore. I was plagued with it through my young life. And also postmenopausal women are really up against it because guess what? You don't have the natural, exactly. Thank you, Christiana. We don't have that natural vehicle anymore. And I came back from India at one point. I had many women friends who were then in their 60s and they were pillars of their community. They were really strong, powerful, kind of like big mothers to so many people in business and, you know, on social service levels and all that. And they were all dying of cancer. And I was like, oh my God, because they don't have the decharging anymore, but they're still operating at full tilt with all the people and all the pain and all the suffering that they're naturally absorbing with their huge motherly natures. And they have no way to offload that. Oh my God, I watched, it was terrifying. And I was realizing, oh my God, they're all postmenopausal. Oh my God, we need to recharge. It's so, you know, like required. And the other thing I want to say is that because we're in a very dense time, we need the physicalized elements through which to decharge. We need the concrete representation to us. So we concretely use the earth element, which I didn't go into, and the water and the fire. Like you need the flame. It's not enough to think, oh, I visualize white light and that cleans me and la, la, la. No, that might've worked in a different millennia, but everything is so densely negative right now that we need the concretized element doorway back to the source. Honestly.
That's a huge point.
It is a huge point. People say, can I just visualize fire? And can I not? It's not going to have the same effectiveness, honestly. So the negative positive energy, the same as the yin yang. Yeah, you could say that. Sure. Why not? Yeah, well, I'd love to if I had two more hours to talk on the other elements, but you can get it at energeticsofselfcare.com because the whole training
of self-care, because right, it's all there and more, right? And yes. There's a community as well.
Yes. Yeah. On Facebook, yeah. I have a Facebook group that's dedicated to these techniques. Yes. Physical activity and exercise, is that decharging at the same level? That is such a great question, Durga. So I will say this, many people try to brute force it, right? By sweating, right? They're working out. I was a long time ago, a Reiki healer and a Reiki master, and I had a huge practice. So I was doing a lot of healing throughout the day. And what I would notice, the way my system hit the energy after was hyper, so hyper, like bouncing off the walls, hyper, which also used to happen when I performed as a pianist, as a classical musician, same thing. 3 a.m., I'm a big party. I cannot go to sleep because I've absorbed so much from the people and the way it hits my system is like completely hyper. So what I would do after a day of healing was I would put on music and I would just dance for like an hour,
desperately trying to calm down this bizarre, like a hamster wheel of energy inside me that I didn't understand what it was. Now I can tell you it was the energy of all the people that I had absorbed through the process of healing that I didn't understand this dynamic. Reiki people didn't understand it. And so I was kind of like trying to flail my way through finding a way to decharge. So it's a kind of, you could take 3 hours to run or do a workout or go on a treadmill or do some kind of physical something to try to address this. But we're really talking about subtle energy. Whereas if you go to the energetic root of the thing, 10 minutes is gone. I mean, gone, dissolved, gone, fresh. The whole, canvas is clean again for another painting tomorrow. That you won't find by working out. It's an attempt at relief, but it's not getting to the energetic root of it.
I think it's as close as you can get without addressing the energetics of it. You know, I know a firefighter who goes out and surfs
every day
and says it is my therapy. It is my spirituality. It's everything to be out in the water. And I'm thinking, okay, you know, surrounded by that.
It's a facsimile of it. Mm-hmm. Yes. You know, like I had a dentist in Santa Cruz who actually two things. One, he told me when he was a kid, because we had this conversation, he was kind of young and I could see that he wasn't all beat up yet from everything he was taking from his patients. And I was curious, like, what do you do? I sort of broached the subject. I could see he was kind of a brick wall. So I was like, all right, whatever, you're doing my teeth, fine. But he said, oh, every weekend, my wife and I and our two little kids go out to the Sierras and we spend the entire weekend hiking. That's what we do. I was like, you're trying in nature to get it absorbed out of you. Nature itself is very absorbent. There will be a measure of decharging by, let's say, being in the water or being around a fire or being out in nature and having nature itself, you know, relieve you of some of that stress and tension. However, if you apply the intention to it, the gratitude and the intention, wow, thank you so much, nature, for this beautiful forest I'm walking through that has all these elements represented, right? Thank you. Right now I'm decharging, even while I'm walking. Thank you. Right now I'm getting rid of whatever I picked up today. It will amplify the effect 1,000-fold and it will accelerate the process of decharging. You don't have to spend the whole damn weekend. You just spend like 30 minutes and you're done. So it's so efficient. It's like stupid, easy, ridiculous, and difficult to remember that this is possible. That same dentist told me when he was a kid, their family dentist in Palo Alto was famous for mixing cocktails and then treating his patients. Guy get loaded with everybody and then do dentistry. Of course, one could not do that today, but I guess in the 60s, that was a thing. Like, well, the guy needed a decharge so desperately. He's just medicating all the, oh, like, oh. Okay, good. Wow. You're out hiking. That's something.
Something. Good. Okay. So I don't think there are any more questions. I do want to, she says you're an amazing woman. And a joy to listen to. Well, that was my impression as well.
Wow. Thank you so much. I would love to take credit, but I think it's the divinity, not me, but I'm happy to be the instrument. Thank you. Yes. Energetics. Okay. Selfcare.com is for this knowledge about decharging. And there's a parallel system called integrative meditation that allows you to meditate throughout the day effectively with mantra that increases your resilience and your protectiveness. So actually you have less to decharge at the end of the day. And the other one is UCBK.org. That's kind of my main gig. And that's where you can find the live stream fire homas and other spiritual teachings and classes.
And I wanted to note that with tomorrow's full moon, you are going to be doing a homa.
6 p.m. Pacific time. Yes.
So if you're interested in getting that energetic boost, check that out at UCBK. I think you have people register for that, right?
We do indeed. Yes. And then we send the links to where we live stream so that everybody can join. Yeah, we do like to get some donation for the intensity of that fire and the work that it does. And Donna Lee wrote, thank you, a lot to process with this new way of thinking about the elements. Yes, they're
I love that idea of being I'm really kind of passionate about being in partnership with the subtle energies and the energies of the elements and nature spirits and all of that. So a lot to explore, a lot to, I think a lot of potential for real mutual benefit.
Yeah.
And this is the time, right?
Yes, I do feel like we're at a pivotal moment as a planet, and certainly in the US as a society, that we desperately need the enlivened relationship with the elements, with nature, qua nature, but also with the supernatural, which really goes hand in glove with the natural world. And it feels to me like the invitation is, you know, you can have that relationship, you can develop that, particularly when you have the exact formulas and the exact technology. Really, it's a spiritual technology. Like everything I learned in India, everything comes back again and again and again to the five elements of nature, how they operate in us, how they operate in the natural world, and what is this conversation, if you will, between them in a supernatural fashion as well. That is the source of the miracle energy, by the way. It's only coming through the five elements. Mm. Everything is coming from the elements. I mean, the elements we could talk about for hours and not even touch the essence of it, but there's a lot of profound knowledge from the ancient saints of like 2000, 5000, 7000 years ago, who were generous enough to write down their experience and their exact consciousness formulas about the five elements and how they operate practically. Mm. Yes, whole other big subject.
Exactly. Such wonderful things. And I'm so grateful for the timing of your talk and for being here and for giving us this tool to get through. And if you want to find more tools, go to energeticsofselfcare.com. So yes. Thank you everyone for being here. Thank you, Alx. Just a joy to be with you and to experience your energy.
It's mutual.
Yeah. Thank you. All right. Good night, everyone. We'll see you next.